Hello everyone, welcome back to another session in Dentistry Ammo. So we have the most important part of FPD, that is a fixed partial denture. The principles of tooth preparation is very important question. So it's been asked every 2 years as an essay question, or you might get a single principle as a short note. So you just cannot skip this chapter for your exam preparation. So tooth preparation has basically five principles. They are preservation of tooth structure, the retention and resistance form, the structural durability, the marginal integrity, and preservation of the periodontium. Now we can classify a requirement of a tooth preparation into these three broad categories, that is biological, mechanical, and aesthetic. In biological, we need to think about the pulp vitality maintenance and the adjacent teeth and the soft tissues, and we need to conserve the tooth structure. In mechanical, we have the resistance and retention form. In aesthetic, it includes the minimal display of metal and the adequate thickness of porcelain and proper shade matching. So when all these three factors combine to produce the best tooth preparation, so we have the five principles of tooth preparation. So we'll start with the first one, that is preservation of the tooth structure. So as per definition, the tooth preparation is a process of removal of diseased and or healthy enamel, dentin and cementum to shape a tooth to receive a restoration. Okay, so the first principle, preservation of tooth structure, where we need to preserve the tooth structure, that is the remaining tooth structure, with some guidelines. So the guidelines will change when the tooth we prepare is partial, veneer, or complete restoration. So the guideline changes according to the restoration we are planning, or the crown we are planning, and also it changes with respect to the finish line, that is supragingival and subgingival. Subgingival has more chances of disturbing the periodontium. So the preparation of teeth with the minimal practical convergence angle should be made, that is between the axial walls. So it should be having minimal convergence of axial walls. Then regarding the occlusal reduction, we should make the anatomic planes with respect to the reduction protocol. We just cannot reduce the surface as such. We need to follow the occlusal plane, then only there will be good preservation of tooth structure. We should not destroy the tooth structure unnecessarily. We should just follow the cusp and all the tooth anatomy in order to receive the restoration. So that is the next point, occlusal reduction. We should follow the anatomic plane. The first one was minimal axial wall convergence, and it should change based on the type of restoration and based on the type of gingival finish line. And if suppose the axial surface is not in a proper angulation, we need to reposition it orthodontically. The axial wall should be parallel to each other. So if necessary, we need to go for orthodontic repositioning. Okay, so that was about the preservation of tooth structure principle. Next we have the retention and resistance form, that is the second principle. So retention and resistance, they differs in the tooth anatomy, based on the tooth anatomy and the forces being applied on the restoration. So retention, which prevents the removal of the restoration, along the path of insertion or long axis of the tooth preparation. As you see here, it is along the long axis of the tooth or the path of insertion, whereas a resistance, this picture, it is a prevention of dislodgement of the restoration by forces directed in an apical or oblique direction, not the on the long axis. It is on the apical or oblique direction and prevents any movement of the restoration under occlusal forces. So retention is basically on the forces which act on the long axis of tooth or path of insertion. Okay. Whereas a resistance, which the forces when act on apical or oblique direction, that is the basic difference between retention and resistance form. So retention form, we have many things to be considered. They are the dislodging forces, then the geometry of the tooth preparation. So we are talking about the retention form. Okay, retention. So the third one is the roughness of the fitting surface of the restoration, then the material being cemented, then the luting agent being used. So these factors affect the retention form of the restoration. So first one is a dislodging force. The dislodging force. So forces that tend to remove a cemented restoration or a crown along its path of withdrawal. Okay. So if we have a tooth and a restoration, so this is along the path of withdrawal. So FPD, which is subjected to dislodging forces, so those forces, it can be a sticky foot or application of flows. We apply flows under the connector for cleaning the cervical area. So those things can dislodge the restoration. So they are the dislodging forces. Second one is the geometry of tooth preparation. Okay, so in geometry we have many factors. So they are the taper or total occlusal convergence. They're coming all under geometry of tooth preparation. Then taper or TOC, then the substitution of internal features, then the path of insertion, the freedom of displacement, then the length and surface area, then the stress, concentration and type of preparation, all comes under the second factor in the retention form. Okay, don't get confused. So we're talking about the five principles of tooth preparation. So first one we finished, that was the preserving the tooth structure. The second one was retention form and resistance form in the second principle. So this is the second principle. So in that we are studying now is the retention form. It has got five features. So among that, the second feature, geometry of tooth preparation, has again many factors. So that is taper and all this. So we'll look into that one by one. The first one is taper or total occlusal convergence. Okay, taper, it's very important. That is nothing but the inclination, that is the relationship of one wall of preparation to the long axis of the preparation. So how the angulation of the axial wall with respect to the long axis. You can see the picture here. So usually it is 2 to 3 degrees is permissible, that is a 3 degrees. So when opposing surface, both 3 degrees combined to form a 6 degree taper. Okay, so 6 degree taper is a most accepted one. So if we have the external walls, if a preparation is receiving a restoration or a retainer where the external walls should be converging, whereas the restoration or a preparation which is receiving an inlay or something like that, the internal walls, so the internal axial walls should diverge. Okay, So this is converging, that is external wall should be converging, whereas the internal walls should be diverging. Okay, you can see the picture. This is convergence, this is divergence. So as per theory, the parallel axial walls provide maximum retention. Okay, so how do we make now visualize the taper of the preparation? So we need to properly visualize it. Proper visualization will prevent formation of any undercuts. And as I said, the ideal taper is 6 degrees. So as per this graph, can see the retention form on the y-axis and the degree of taper on the x-axis. You can see as the degree of taper increases, the retention decreases. So you can see the retention is highest at between the 5 and 10 degree, that is around 6 degree, we get the highest retention. And it decreases as we increase the taper. So you get the idea, if we increase the taper, we'll lose the retention. Okay. So as I said, 2 to 6 degree is permissible. Now we have the second one, the substitution of internal features in geometry of tooth preparation. If the opposing walls are not available, okay, so basically we should provide opposing axial walls with minimal taper. But what if we don't have proper axial wall because of destroyed wall, because of severe attrition, or if you are providing a partial veneer restoration? So in such cases, we need to give the internal features for retention, such as grooves, box and pinholes. Okay, so like this, we need to provide additional retention features. Next is a path of insertion. So path of insertion is nothing but an imaginary line along which the restoration will be placed onto and removed from the preparation. This is the path of insertion. So path of all FPD abutments must be parallel each other. Okay, so it should be parallel each other, to not get locked inside. So we need to have a visual survey to ensure the preparation is not having undercuts or over tapered. Just like this picture, we need to have a visual survey. So while doing visual survey, the center of the occlusal surface of the preparation is viewed from 30 centimeter distance or 12 inch distance with just one eye. Okay, not a binocular vision, just one eye. Because binocular vision, if we look at the preparation with two eyes, this undercut preparation can appear to have an acceptable taper. So never use both eyes to have the visual survey on the prepared tooth. Only use one eye and keep a distance of 12 inch or 30 centimeter. So in patient's mouth, we can use a mouth mirror which can be held at an angle approximately half inch above the preparation. Okay, so we can also keep a firm finger rest. Okay, so firm finger rest can be established for the visual survey. So this firm finger rest is nothing but the mirror which is maneuvered until one preparation is entered. So we place the mirror, if we have two preparation, we just keep the mirror where the one prepared tooth is at the center of the mirror. Okay, then the mirror moved by pivoting on the finger rest without change in angulation till the second preparation is centered. That is how we can make sure that it is having no undercuts or no over tapering. That is a firm finger rest. The mirror maneuvered until one preparation is centered, then the mirror moved by pivoting of the finger rest without changing the angulation. We should not change the angulation. We keep the mirror in one position so that the prepared tooth is at its center, then just change the pivoting, just pivot, move by pivoting the finger rest without change its angulation till the second preparation is centered. Just move it without changing the angulation and see the second preparation so that both the prepared tooth is having, or we can make sure that having the common path of insertion. So that is a process. You can see the picture here. So the path of insertion is considered in two dimensions, that is a mesiodistally and facialingually. A mesiodistal inclination should be parallel to the contact areas of adjacent teeth. Okay, so it should be parallel to the contact area of adjacent teeth, otherwise it will be locked out. We will not get the path of insertion. So that was the mesiodistal inclination, whereas a facial lingual inclination, which affects basically the aesthetics of metal ceramic and partial veneer crown. Okay, so for full veneer crown, we need to have parallel, which should be on the long axis, parallel to the long axis of the tooth. That is a facial and lingual orientation should be parallel to long axis of the tooth, whereas the facially inclined path of insertion should be for the partial veneer crown, or it should keep a facial prominent facio occlusal line angle, or over contouring or opaque show through for the partial veneer crown. Okay, whereas for full veneer crown, we need to have the parallel long axis. That is a facial lingual orientation. For posterior 3-4 crown, it should be parallel to the long axis of the tooth, and anterior 3-4 crown should be parallel to the incisal 1/2 of the labial surface. Now we have the freedom of displacement. Freedom of displacement, the number of paths along which a restoration can be removed from the tooth preparation, that is the freedom of displacement. Only one path will provide maximum retention. Okay, so that is a freedom of displacement. Now only one path should be there. Now we have the length and surface area. So the longer preparation, there will be more surface area and it provides more retention. And the length must be great enough to interfere with the arc of casting pivoting about a point on margin on opposite side of restoration. Okay, so it should be great enough to interfere with the arc of the casting pivoting, okay, about a point on the margin on opposite side of restoration. And if there is short preparation, the inclination will be on a critical site. For smaller tooth, it will be having a short rotation radius, so we need to provide grooves in the axial wall, so it will reduce the rotation radius. So if we don't have any grooves, it will be a bigger one. So in order to reduce the rotation radius, we provide grooves in the axial wall. So that was the length and surface area. Now we have the stress concentration. So stress concentration, it will be around the junction of axial and occlusal surface. So we need to round the internal line angles to reduce the stress concentration. And lastly, the type of preparation, which is coming under geometry of tooth preparation. So complete crown, there will be the type of preparation, that is more preparation needed for the complete crown compared to the partial crowns. So we can provide more grooves, boxes, which will give better retention. Okay, so that was about the geometry of tooth preparation. Now we have the roughness of the fitting surface of restoration. So roughening or grooving the restoration will improve the retention. Okay, which can be done by air abrasion, that is using 50 micrometer alumina, which will improve the surface energy or the surface area, which will increase the retention. Whereas a roughening of the tooth preparation is not basically recommended. So roughening or grooving the restoration is recommended, not the tooth preparation. Okay, only the roughness of the fitting surface of the restoration will improve the retention, not the prepared tooth. Now the material being cemented. So retention affected both by the casting alloy and the core buildup material. So the more reactive the alloy is, the more adhesion there will be with the certain loading agents, such as type 1 and type 2 gold alloys for intracoronal restoration, and type 3 and type 4 gold alloys for crown and FPD. So the type 1 and 2 gold for intracoronal, whereas type 3 and 4 gold alloy for crowns and FPD, whereas a nickel chromium for long span FPD. That is a material being cemented. Whereas a looting agent being used, adhesive cements are most retentive. That is, a film thickness of looting agent, there is significantly an effect on the retention. So adhesive resin, can put it like this, adhesive resin, then comes the GIC, then comes zinc phosphate, which is almost equal to polycarboxylate, and lastly the zinc oxide eugenol. It is based on the retention, adhesive resin, GIC, zinc phosphate or polycarboxylate, and lastly the zinc oxide eugenol. That is about the looting agent being used. Whereas in resistance form, we have three factors basically. One is the dislodging forces, then looting agent being used, and geometry of the tooth preparation. So this is after our retention form. So the first one is dislodging forces. So mastication and parafunctional activity, they are the substantial, horizontal or oblique forces. So resistance, hope you remember the concept. Retention is through the path of insertion or long axis of the tooth, but the resistance is at apical or oblique direction. Okay, so the dislodging forces such as mastication and parafunctional activity, but it should be on the horizontal or oblique directions. So these lateral forces displace the restoration by causing rotation around the gingival margin. Next is a looting agent being used. So the resistance to deformation affected by compressive strength and modulus of elasticity. So adhesive resin, then just like our retention, adhesive resin, then the glass anoma cement, then the zinc phosphate, then zinc polycarboxylate, and finally the zinc oxide eugenol. So this is the resistance gradient. Now we have the geometry of tooth preparation. It has got few features. So the factors are type of preparation, freedom of displacement, then the occluso cervical or incisor cervical dimensions, and the ratio of the occluso cervical and facial lingual dimension, and finally the circumferential form of the prepared tooth. So it all comes under the geometry of the tooth preparation. So regarding the resistance form and type of preparation, if it is a partial coverage restoration, it is having less resistance than the complete crown, because there is no buccal resistance area in partial coverage. So we can give grooves or boxes to increase the resistance, because it is greatest if walls are perpendicular in the direction of the force. So that was about the preparation, type of preparation. Regarding the partial and complete, if it is partial, we can provide boxes or grooves. Now we have the freedom of displacement. So in freedom of displacement, the lingual wall should be perpendicular to the direction of force, and in the proximal side, the buccal and lingual wall must meet the palpal wall at 90 degrees. There should not be any oblique ankle. Now we have the occlusio-incisal or incisocervical dimension. So the minimal occlusio-cervical dimension, anterior it is 3 mm, premolar it is 3 mm, molar it is 4 mm, and the ratio with respect to the occlusio-cervical to facio-lingual dimension. So this is not actually facio-lingual, this is incisocervical. Okay, sorry about that. This is incisocervical dimension. So ratio of occlusio-cervical to facio-lingual, it should be 0.4 or higher for all teeth. So if the total occlusal convergence is less than 6 degrees, it will be 0.1, then less than 12 it is 0.2, less than 18 0.3, and less than 24 it is 0.4. Now we have the circumferential form of prepared tooth. So it should possess a circumferential irregularity, that is the maxillary molars it should be in rhomboidal shape, mandibular molars it should be rectangular, premolars and anteriors it should be oval. We should preserve corners of tooth preparation. There should not be any axial grooves. Boxes should be provided in corners. Okay, because the chewing and parafunctional habits can cause dislodging forces largely on the facio-lingual aspect, so grooves and boxes should be on the proximal surface. So that was about the resistance form. Now we have the structural durability. In structural durability, a restoration must contain a minimum bulk of material which is adequate to withstand the force of occlusion. So bulk should be confined to the space created by the tooth preparation. So to provide this adequate bulk, we need to have proper occlusal reduction, then there should be proper axial reduction, and also we need to have proper functional cusp bevel. Okay, all are very important. So in occlusal reduction, for full metal restoration we need to have 1.5 mm on the functional cusp and just 1 mm on non-functional cusp. That is for full metal restoration. Okay, full metal crown. For metal ceramic, that is metal fused to ceramic, in those cases it is 1.5 to 2 mm for functional and just 1 to 1.5 mm for non-functional. Because it has a coping inside, so we need to have more preparation. Whereas for all ceramic crown, okay, for all ceramic crown, the reduction is 2 mm irrespective of the cusp, that is both for functional and non-functional, we need to have 2 mm reduction. That was about occlusal reduction. Now regarding the functional cusp bevel. So wide bevel on the lingual inclines, we should provide wide bevel on lingual inclines on maxillary lingual cusp. Okay, for maxillary lingual cusp we need to provide wide bevel, that is a lingual incline of maxillary lingual cusp and the buccal inclines of mandibular buccal cusp. Okay, so we need to provide wide bevel, that is the lingual incline on the maxillary lingual cusp and the buccal incline of the mandibular buccal cusp should provide wide bevel, and there should be adequate bulk of metal in areas of heavy occlusal contact. So if there is lack of functional cusp bevel, what happens is there will be fracture. It happens in cases such as over inclination or over contouring or thin area in casting, all will result in lack of proper functional cusp bevel and ultimately the fracture of the restoration. Now the axial reduction. So we discussed about the occlusal reduction and functional focus bevel, and finally the axial reduction, okay, which all comes under structural durability. So axial reduction, the thin walls of casting which can result in subject to distortion, and over contouring which can also disastrous effect on the periodontium. So there will be adequate removal of the axial wall, okay. So if there is no adequate removal, it can result into distortion of the retainer or the restoration, or it can affect the periodontium, that is over contouring or under contouring. That was the third principle, structural durability. Now we have the fourth principle, marginal integrity. Marginal integrity is a closely adapted margins. So these finish lines of the preparation, which can determine the aesthetics and the effect of periodontium. So it also depends on the survival of the restoration in the oral environment. So the configuration of finish line, which decides the shape and bulk of the metal in the margins, it affects the marginal it affects the marginal adaptation and the degree of seating. So all is depends on the marginal integrity, and we need to learn about various finish lines. So I'll be taking finish lines as a separate session. So that can be another essay question or short essay, the types of finish line. So I'll be taking that in a separate video. So this was the fourth principle, marginal integrity. So the many finish lines, chamfer, heavy chamfer, shoulder, then the sloped shoulder, radial shoulder, shoulder with a bevel, knife edged, and all those things. And the last principle was fifth principle, the preservation of periodontium. So this was the fifth principle of tooth preparation. So it has a few factors. The main thing is margin placement. So margin placement will affect the periodontium. So direct effect it has on the success of the restoration. So margins should be as smooth as possible, and it should be placed in areas that can be finished well by the dentist and kept clean by the patient. So both factors should be considered. That is, it can be well finished by the dentist as well as it can be kept clean by the patient, and it should be placed in enamel wherever possible, and it should be supragingival whenever possible. Okay, it should be on enamel and supragingival in order to preserve the periodontium. If it is going deeper and deeper to have a better aesthetics, we might have problems in the periodontium. So supragingival margins, we can have supragingival and subgingival margins. So in supragingival margins, there are less potential for the soft tissue damage, and it can be easily prepared and finished more easily, can be cleaned, impressions can be more easily made, restorations easily evaluated at recall appointment. So subgingival margins is becoming a problematic if there is caries, if there is cervical erosion or restoration which is extending subgingivally, and if proximal contact area extend to the gingival crest, we might give the subgingival margins. Additional attention is needed for subgingival margins, and the margin of a metal ceramic crown is to be hidden behind the labio-gingival crest for the aesthetics. Root sensitivity might be there because of the subgingival preparation. Finish line should not be closer than 2 mm to the alveolar crest. Okay, placement in this area can result in gingival inflammation, pocket formation or loss of alveolar crest height. So that was all about the principles, that is the fifth principle, that is the preservation of periodontium. And along with that, how do we prevent the damage during tooth preparation? So we can prevent using various strategies. One is prevention of adjacent teeth by using a metal matrix band, leave a slight lip or fin of proximal enamel there, and protection of soft tissue by careful retraction of lips and cheeks, care to protect tongue when lingual surface of the mandibular molars are prepared. And pulp, we need to think about the temperature being created and the chemical action of the cements being applied and the chances of micro leakage. So if the rise in temperature without coolant, you can see here 1 millimeter dip, the rise in temperature without coolant is 0.54 degree, 2 mm depth is 1 degree and 3 mm depth is 1.84. Okay, with coolant it is comparatively low, it is 0.40, 0.82 and 1.13 respectively. So that was all about various principles of tooth preparation. So we discussed about 5 main principles, and the second principle, that is retention and resistance, was a bit long. It has got many additional factors. So the 5 principles were the preservation of tooth structure, retention and resistance from structural durability, marginal integrity and preservation of the periodontium. So in that, the retention and resistance form has many other features such as dislodging force, geometry of tooth preparation, roughness of the fitting surface of the restoration, material being cemented and luting agent being cemented. In that, the second one, geometry of tooth preparation, includes lots of factors such as taper, path of insertion, freedom of displacement, length and surface area, stress concentration, type of preparation and all that. So this is very, very, very important for the exam. It is very commonly asked essay question, principles of tooth preparation, or each principle can be asked as a short essay or short note. So never ever miss this question for your exam. So next I'll be coming with the finish lines, which comes under actually marginal integrity. So we need to discuss in detail. So I'll come up with that topic in my next video. So hope you understood. Make sure that you learn this for your final exam. Thank you.